6 months, I've received numerous emails on the outstanding work he's done in handling a variety of tree issues. Michael comes to us from the city of San Antonio, where he spent 6.5 years building a community forest program, which he hopes to implement here in the city of Norfolk. Michael's presentation today will elaborate on a wonderful partnership, a public-private partnership, which will actually enhance beautification in the city, increase our tree canopy, as well as actually establish a partnership that works. So at this time, I present to you Michael Nitwich, our city forester.
Good evening. Just want to go over this partnership that Daryl mentioned, and thank you for the opportunity to come here and you know, let you know what we're doing to try to improve our canopy around the city. Thank you. So this donation came in from the Hampton Roads Community Foundation, and the whole idea here is to, you know, really get on board with trying to increase our canopy. The goal that was set by the city of Norfolk is 40%, okay? But that really doesn't mean a whole lot unless we know where we are today. So where we are today is 33%, okay? This was a study that was done, and, you know, how many trees do we need to make up that 7% canopy? Well, I did some figures, and based on approximately a 32-foot canopy spread for an average-sized tree for this area, and that's, you know, looking at the species around the area that, you know, small species, large species, and bringing that all together, and you get about a 32-foot average canopy spread. And that means we actually need to plant approximately 113,000 trees to make up that 7%. So how do we do this? Well, we need initiatives like street tree planting, which is what we're going to be discussing tonight, living legacy groves, which thank you, Mayor, for your initiative and really pushing that forward. And we just did the one at Community Beach Park, so thank you for being there. Arbor Day tree seedling giveaways, where we work with the master gardeners and growing these seedlings and adopting those out to citizens to try to get them more involved and really build that partnership. Because without the community's involvement, you know, it's going to be very difficult to get there. And then obviously, like we're going to discuss tonight, these private tree donations. So we're here to actually request this donation. It's $20,000 from the Hampton Roads Community Foundation. The whole understanding that they have is that if we plant trees, people will come. They'll come because we have more beauty in the city. Trees are pretty things, and people want to see them, and it brings other things along with that. We all know that trees, you know, produce oxygen. But other things that trees provide are going to be clean air, clean water, stormwater control, which is really important in our area, and also what people don't always think about and remember is that when it brings people to the community because of the beauty of the trees, it improves commerce. And that's something everybody can agree is really important. So out of all these trees that are coming in, it's approximately 55 trees. We have swamp white oaks, white fringe tree, and crepe myrtle. And there's going to be 46 swamp white oaks, approximately 6 white fringe trees, and I believe it's 3 Natchez crepe myrtles. And the swamp white oaks and all of this together, you'll see going down the corridor there, is really going to enhance the beauty and actually tie into a lot of the canopy that's already there. So what we didn't want to do is do something that was going to be so drastic of a change that it might look odd. All of this will tie in together, and the species that we have here can actually be okay with some periodic flooding, which could possibly happen in along those areas. So we wanted to make sure that what we put in is going to last. Okay, so matching funds are not required for this project. This is strictly all part of that donation. Everything will be taken care of through those funds. And the tree canopy coverage will be increased by approximately 3 acres along that corridor. So within that stretch is actually going to be increased quite a bit. So the planting will be completely performed by a contractor. So Parks and Urban Forestry, Recreation Parks and Open Space will move forward with getting the contract together and following on with that contract to make sure everything is installed done properly. So when we went, we thought, okay, well, we want to make sure that we're getting the Tree Commission on board. We presented to the Tree Commission. Tree Commission says more trees, improving the environment, improving our area, bringing more commerce. Absolutely. What's not to like about this project? We went to Public Works and said, you know, is there any issue? Do you have see any issue with where we're going to put these trees to see if there's any clear vision issues? Are there any reasons not to put anything, any conflicts? Absolutely not. Go for it. We like it. Wonderful. So we thought, okay, let's make this happen. We want to get this done by the end of planting season this year, so all the trees will be good to go.
Planting season is when?
So you can start planting trees basically coming into October, but we want to finish by February. You can plant into March. But for us, we want to make sure that we finish, you know, into February. So that way we can make sure that when the trees go in, we don't have frozen soils here. You'll still get root development throughout the winter. And then when that spring, you know, growth flush hits, trees are going to be in the ground ready to rock and roll. They'll be good to go. And this is just kind of I just want to give a visual representation of kind of the south end of where this is going to be and looking kind of north. And you'll see how these trees are going to come in. And from north looking south, and you'll see how these trees are going to look along that corridor there. As you drive down there and these trees get big, these trees can get 60 to 70 feet tall and actually have about a 60-foot canopy spread. So as these trees get big, you'll have that nice corridor look along there that you can drive by and really appreciate, you know, hey, you're coming into the city of Norfolk, here's what you see, and appreciate the project.
What size trees are you putting?
We're looking at a 2-inch caliper.
If it's coming under that, what are you going to do? Are you going to add more
corridors?
This is Hampton Boulevard?
But it's north of...
I'm sorry. North of the yacht club.
That's the yacht club right there.
So it's going to go from the yacht club all the way down to essentially the naval base. So we're talking that whole line of...
So it'll go north of Little Creek?
Bowling to Terminal. So it'll go all the way up to north
Bowling
of Terminal.
Bowling also?
Uh-huh. From Bowling all the way to Terminal, right. Essentially.
Oh.
So we'll be on both sides of the bridge.
Other side of the bridge, too.
Absolutely. So this is pretty substantial.
Do trees slow trucks and cars down?
That's a great question, and thank you for asking that. I love that question because
pine cones and mm-hmm.
for every single right for every single you know thing that is somebody might consider maybe an ill of a city, you can say, well, the trees actually will cure that. So if you have traffic issues, plant trees. It'll slow the traffic down. People tend to kind of look around and notice more. You'll get a calming effect too with the trees there. So that actually has another effect on traffic. Slows it down. People see the beauty, especially when you start to see some fall color in there, and people will kind of slow down to look at that.
But if your bids come in under, are you going to add trees somewhere else? Because, I mean, that's almost $400 a tree.
And right. So part of what we're looking at here is the trees will have a 2-year warranty, so that will be built in too. So that'll what we don't want to do is we don't want to get into a situation where if we get into a drought, that the trees are only on a 1-year warranty and, you know, we don't actually meet that. They have a problem after that first year warranty is up. So we have that 2-year warranty. So that'll take up some of that cost. If we do have some extra funds and we will look around, we do have some other options that we can look at as well.
You're going to have funds for it. A tree that lives 1 year, 95% of them are fine after that. That's just my personal opinion. And those trees shouldn't cost over a couple $100 planted each.
That's your professional.
Right. It's 44 years, so it hasn't been doing that.
You've all been planted in the verge in the middle.
Real quickly. One, Daryl, great job hiring him. So since he's come on board, I've noticed a lot of changes and being more proactive. Well, good job for hiring. Anyway.
I didn't do that.
But I just have a quick, can we put something, do we have a link that citizens can recommend trees placement?
Yes, sir.
We do,
absolutely.
Okay. I don't know if
we have one, but we need to define it some more and
okay.
We'll work on that.
All right, because I get requests all the time for people and I'd like to send them to that link. And the other thing is, I know Dominion Power we accepted money from them to replace the trees that they took down. Is that money set aside somewhere to replace those trees?
Yes.
Or is it, or we're not using it to offset anything, are we?
No, sir. That's especially earmarked for tree replacement for Dominion Power projects.
Okay. But not necessarily in that area, because they don't want us to put trees back that they took down.
I'm curious about this, where you had about the tree donation project. I think it's a really exciting idea. I mean, to really kind of get people involved. Like, I'm interested that this gentleman decided that that was what how he wanted to contribute. What are we doing to market that idea? I mean, I think a lot of people would be excited about the idea of planting a tree in honor of somebody or to memorialize, and they may not know how to do that.
Absolutely, and what we're looking at doing, or one of my goals here, is to make sure that, you know, really working with Daryl and talking about some of the things that, you know, that we did, you know, that I've done in the past, and really trying to bring that here is, you know, really trying to get a central focus on, you know, celebrate trees, make that our goal, and then say, okay, if you have a question, go here. This is where we need you to go. We're working on our website, like Daryl said, and make sure that if anybody says anything, wants trees, has questions about it, go to that central point of contact. If we have that central point of contact, then we'll be able to answer those, follow up, and then steer people where to go to try to keep this going.
But I'm even thinking of giving people the idea of doing it.
Sure.
You know, instead Absolutely. Of them having to look for a site to be able to do it.
And so that's part of what we hope to do with this. It was an anonymous donation made through the Community Foundation. And so the idea is that maybe there'll be momentum. If we do this really right and prove to the public that we can commit to something and follow through and see kind of the fruit of it, if you will, that other people will follow upon.
Well, I mean, we've done that. And, I mean, just the tree we planted the other day at Ocean View, the Kiwanis Club down there. I mean, we had three of them. The Lions Club were supportive. The first ones we built over it, the first ones we planted in Lakewood had sponsors. I mean, we have...
I just mean, you know, I think it'd be great to let get the average folk out there to know. I mean, we've done well thus far, but we can always do better. So
I'd like to see a program where you could buy a tree for your birthday and plant it and give it to the city. You know, I mean... Or somebody could buy a tree for somebody's birthday. You'd be surprised how many. Our sister city in Japan does that, and they plant thousands of trees.
So do you have to have the number of rings around the tree?
Yeah.
Mine would be a really big tree.
This is really, Michael, welcome on board. And I think, you're doing all the right things for sure. I'm glad to see you're purchasing some crepe myrtles. Somebody came in here once and said... Was it you, Daryl? We don't like crepe myrtles. I said, wait a minute, who made that decision? This is weed stuff. I mean, color makes a lot of difference, too.
But there's some science behind that, too, that if there were a blight in crepe myrtles and you had a preponderance of those, then your city canopy is preponderantly
right,
lost.
Right, we're looking at right tree in the right location.
Right.
And
balance means everything, but they didn't like maintaining it. Crepe myrtles. There was nothing wrong with the crepe myrtles. They didn't like them in the mediums, and it was just some people didn't like them.
Fred Hewitt would be proud of it.
I know my father did it with Fred.
Two things to add. Since we're talking about trees, I know I see Dean sitting back there. Royal Creek area, we had an abundance of dead trees that we haven't replaced. So while we're talking about trees, can we get those dead trees replaced that have been dead for quite some time? And, you know, we're supposed to replace them.
We were doing a survey of that area, and it'll be on this year's planting.
Thank you. The second thing is, as it relates to these trees, you know, I don't know who's cutting these trees back, but in the Verge, you see where the power lines are. You ever go down the street and you see how they cut those trees it looks awful. I was going down Azalea Garden Road, and the way that they cut those trees, the tops off them, and, you know, it looks awful. I mean, it's not attractive at all. If you look, they cut right through the middle of the tree, and half of it is leaning over, and they take half of it. I understand pruning and take them, but at least give it some some shape, but it looks awful. I mean, it would be great if we could underground utilities, but...
We can regulate that?
It's actually,
Bernard said we can regulate.
It's actually pretty interesting if you hear Dominion Power come in and talk to you about it. I mean, as horrible as it looks, there's a real science in how they're doing that. And they have a forester that works and does this. And the first thing they'll tell you is our mistakes are that we're growing trees underneath power lines that are inappropriate. And they really, as scary as it looks, if you listen to them and their forester about it, they're as anxious as we are for them to look good. It's just difficult when you've got lines that are going right through a tree.
And they're also very strict now about what they'll let you plant anywhere near the line.
Right.
So this is a mistake that's been hundreds of years.
Exactly.
But now, the last 10 or 15 years,
And that's why you got to plant crate myrtles, because they don't grow that.
Yeah, that's right. No. Michael, there is a tree pit just south of our pump station on Bush Street that has somebody ran over the tree. I remember when it broke. Probably a year and a half ago, we have not put a tree in it since then.
Couple over here.
There, if you just, it's on the north. It's over by the seawall, just south of the.
You need to bring them back. Bring the tree commission.
The pump station.
We need to have a whole tree meeting.
Okay.
College.
Okay. Let's go. Great.
You love our trees.
Evening.
I love trees. Members of council, you have some items on your agenda tonight. As the mayor mentioned, they'll be combined R12 through 28 for some property easements, construction, and sidewalk easements relating to a project for drainage improvements on Orange Avenue. This is a project that's been a community request, something we've been working on for a number of years, and we're finally to the point where we're ready to start construction. As you see, there's some significant drainage problems along Orange Avenue. From rainfall, there is no underground drainage system. The project will install a pipe network as well as some sidewalks along here. The project, the cost estimate was more than we could afford until we were able to get VDOT revenue sharing money through council ordinances in 2011 and 2012. We've been finishing the design and working on the property issues, and what's on your agenda tonight are the property easements. Here you see this shows where the sidewalks are, but each of the captions indicate the locations of the property easements. In some cases, a permanent easement for a little bit of sidewalk. In other cases, it's a construction easement to allow the contractor to get on there to do the construction. The total cost of all of these easements is $4,647, and those are on your docket tonight.
And we just wanted to bring it to you. That's the way to pick up. The people over there appreciate it.
Thank you.
It's horrible. Absolutely horrible. And that wasn't Prince of St. County either. That's interesting. That was part of Ocean View, wasn't it?
The last item we have, Mayor, members of council, is just, as I mentioned earlier, I believe it's PH 9, is the only item that is on the formal docket tonight that deals with the charter change, the legislative package. My understanding is that that's pretty clear. The number of meetings and the chief deputy for the police chief in that appointment, and then I think there was just one outstanding issue related to the school board.
With the meetings again, because Barkley and I had a conversation before the meeting. It doesn't prohibit us from having the same amount of meetings. It just doesn't hold us to it. Okay,
that's right.
Because we don't need another meeting with 70 something items on the agenda, right?
Yeah.
Particularly when we had that one meeting that only lasted an hour. Remember that?
We're trying to balance this. Balance.
But Winter's still in charge.
Here.
Put that one.
I don't think our schedule will change at all, Bart. I mean, going forward, we'll still be having two voting meetings every month, and in a couple of at least informal session meetings. So it just keeps us from getting strapped. And
can I ask a question about the agenda? The part about the school board that. Terms of the school board and the rest of the legislative agenda, they're on the last item, right?
It's the last item.
Okay, now, we have five people here, six people, and it takes five to pass this thing. And if we have two dissenting, then the whole legislative package goes away over a disagreement about the term of the school board. You understand what I'm saying? How do we...
If that were the case, you could re-vote
without that item. You could carve that out of that ordinance if you weren't getting five votes for it and you wanted to.
Should we carve it out for and let them vote on it at the next meeting? You know, would we have time to do that?
Let's see where we are.
Well, I mean,
okay,
it's,
because
you know, when I look,
it only takes a majority, doesn't it?
No,
I think it takes five votes.
Five votes.
You know, and we don't have.
Well, I'm the only one, aren't I?
Let's kill it, Terry.
Yeah, that, seriously. I mean, you know, I don't think there's
well,
any
you,
problem.
Can you support the entire legislative package?
Yeah, I can support it. I think they'll.
Okay. Well, that's helpful.
Do we have comments that came in on the legislative package that are going to be shared with us? Because we're voting on something tonight, and we asked for public comment, but we haven't had an opportunity to look at it.
They're in the Dropbox.
Where was it in the Dropbox? It was
under memos.
There was maybe two. One or two.
We provided the entirety of all comments received. I think it's around 19, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, it was a lot.
Okay.
Problem is, we kind of went around this thing backwards because we had discussion and I thought everybody had agreed and a compromise. And then we got in front of our legislators and we started debating it. So they're thinking these guys really don't know what they want.
Well, that was only me that debated.
My
issue was I was confused about how we got to talking to the legislators before we'd heard from the public. And it seemed to me that we should have had our agenda out there and then heard comments from the public like we do at open meetings and then decided on it. And I mean, I realize people say, you know, all this had been vetted out, but I was confused. I thought that we would have public comments on it and then we would come up with our agenda. And I understand we had some confusion with dates and getting the legislators together, but I was caught a little blindsided by it.
Frankly. I think that's a fair comment. I'm
kind of disappointed because I think we all know there are a fair number of people out there that were not in favor of the three. And I think there was, you know, and now again, this is my opinion. But when it came up and said, okay, we've decided on three, I wasn't sure who decided on three. It just seemed like all of a sudden that came up and we said, okay, we're at three. And
when we left the retreat, it was an open discussion still.
Right.
Even Paul Riddick said he would consider four at the time and that we would come back with that information. So I was caught off guard a little bit with it too. The public comments weren't there on Friday. They were added 4 hours ago. So that's why. Right. Okay. So I'm not losing my mind.
Yeah. And I'll have to admit, some of us do not look at the board, you know, because I'm working right up until we get here. So if it isn't there Monday night, it isn't there. So I think that needs to be taken into effect if we decide that that information is important on our decision.
Then we can vote on the legislative agenda tonight, right? We'll have five votes. And Terry, you can vote against it. Okay.
Well, I mean, I kind of disagree with the argument in terms of, you know, this is not the first time we've talked about this issue. It was one time we talked about direct elected school boards. So, I mean, the conversations have been had. I thought that the compromise came from the public. I didn't think the compromise came from this body. I thought it was that, you know, there were folk out there that were in support of Florida, and we had two, and we looked at the data and decided that we would go three as a compromise. I didn't think the compromise, again, came from this body. I thought it came from whether it be Norfolk Gaines or the people that they had spoken with in the community, and I thought that, you know, that was moving forward. Three was the compromise, and we would see how it worked with three, and you know, based on the information that we received from the administration. So I didn't think it would, but again, if you want to say that there are people out there that believe that we should go forward, there are just as many people out there to say we should have a direct elected school board. And so we decided to do something rather than to do nothing and to provide balance and go three instead of two and see how it worked. So I thought that's where we were, but there has been substantial conversation as relates to what direction we should go as relates to how we deal with school boards the school board and the city of Norfolk.
Okay, well, that puts that to a close then. Okay. So we actually, I didn't think we'd have enough time to get through this thing. But we do. We can start right at 7 on the nose. Okay?
Because we got all 72 items.
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Okay. One voting meeting this month.
It was winter.
Joe's gonna fix it.
Even 36.
If you guys have the opportunity, you should read the comments that came in on the legislative. In your 20 minutes extra, there's some good comments from the public about why there should be a four-year term and compare and contrast. But anyway, just take the time to. I don't want the public's comments to be dismissed because we just got them 4 hours ago.
And I wouldn't. I mean, there's going to be an opportunity for people to speak tonight too. But you know, this is one of those instances, and I mean, we're settled, so I don't want to pull it back up. But I'm not sure there's any right or wrong answer here. I mean, people do things differently. I mean, and I'm not sure there's anything special about four as opposed to three. And the managers, you know, did a survey of school boards that had been appointed. That was the distinction, and that's why they recommended three. And
not
so,
to mention, if the argument is stability on the school board, I asked Breck to go back for 10 years and look at how many individuals the council had not reappointed after their first term. And originally there was only one in 10 years that had not been reappointed for a second 2-year term. But then Breck was mistaken because that person sent in a letter asking not to be reappointed. We've only had, so with that, we've had 3 people in 10 years who have said after their first 2-year term, they did not wish to be reappointed. So, I mean, I see either way, you've got folks on the school board who have at least served 4 years. So a 3-year term, it does increase, I guess, maybe their comfort level. But I think if somebody's doing a really good job on the board and they come before this council and they say they'd like to be reappointed for a 3-year term, and, I mean, they have been found to be dancing on the bar stool somewhere, I think we would reappoint them. I mean, really.
Has it been worked out how this is going to be staggered in, or is it?
The legislative language. Bernard, do you want to speak to that, or Brian?
Yeah, Brett.
Okay, it's ready. You want to see it? I mean, do you want to talk about it?
Yeah, I'm curious to see, are we doing this in the next term? Are those people going to be appointed for 3 years? And then, were you doing two at a time? What are you?
I think that the statute just changes the term to
3 years.
Three, and so that your next appointments will be for 3, and they're already staggered. So the staggering will continue at 3.
No, well, one of them will be. Well, we'll work it out. It's because we've been doing 3 and 4.
Right.
Right. And so if
four
we,
of them
we
will
can't,
go.
Yeah. Yeah. So. We'll have to. It should be 3, 2, and 2 in the future, right?
Right. That's what I'm asking.
Yeah.
Is it?
So we should
so
work
it's not,
that out.
It doesn't work out that way, Bernard. Because if you did it half and half, then you'd have a year nobody was had come up.
And so
you
one
had
of these
2 years that you were doing it, and then 1 year you didn't do it.
Law effective July 1. If you were successful.
No, but what Tommy's getting to.
Right.
We'll have to figure that detail out.
Yeah.
I don't know if we have 3 or 4 members up this time, but
we just appointed
three.
So we'll have four members up, and so two of them will be.
No, we did 4. We just did 4, didn't we? Kirk,
okay. Well, we'll
Brad.
You'll have to just put some
Warren,
pencil on the paper.
Was it there one more?
We're not voting
right.
on that tonight, right?
We just did 4. So
you're pulling that out?
No, we're going to vote on it tonight. We got 5 votes. We're okay.
We got the votes.
Oh, so you voted?
No,
Tommy's
you've got 5 votes.
Okay, we're good. Okay, let's do it.